So this is something I've wanted to talk about for a while. I have a lot of memories playing Minions of Mirth years ago, and I've always wanted to talk about it, but seemingly every gamer I've spoken to about it didn't know what I was talking about or just nodded along like they were talking to a crazy person. Now though, I've finally sat down and organized some of my thoughts about the game, along with some history of where it began, where it went, and what's going on with it now. Minions of Mirth is a free-to-play 3D MMORPG that was first released back in 2005. It was developed by Prairie Games using the Torque engine, and it was programmed with Python, the same language that EVE Online originally used. It stayed online until September of 2017, where in a social media post they said, "From Immortal Savage, Minions of Mirth is offline indefinitely. Thank you for the years of adventurous fun." This tweet came as a bit of a surprise to a very active and tight-knit community. But before we talk about the end, I want to go back to the beginning, and not only talk about my experiences with the game, but the developers and why this exists in the first place. According to an article written in May of last year on The Game Archaeologist, in the fall of 2003, married couple Josh Ritter and Laura Ingebrigtsen, I probably messed that up, co-founded Prairie Games, a small California software studio that aimed to make an ambitious online RPG. Josh had experiences as a programmer, while Laura was an artist who came out of the Art Institute of Colorado, and so they thought, somehow, this could be done on a very strict budget. Ritter worked professionally in the gaming industry and was a programmer when MMORPGs began hitting the market. From the very beginning, he knew he wanted to develop something like this. However, being a solo developer on such a project would be a huge undertaking. He began outsourcing work, and soon there was a virtual team of around 35 people. Development of Minions of Mirth moved quickly, and in under a year, it went from an idea to full-on development. According to a quote by Ritter, "Minions of Mirth's development was a blur of fear, work, and stress. The work schedule was extremely rigorous and focused. It was like living in a cult. We were highly motivated and stressed by the fear of our impending financial doom." Soon, though, the game was prepared to launch, and in December of 2005, it was released on Mac and PC. The game was originally released free to play, but you could pay for a full-featured premium version for a one-time cost of $30. Needless to say, I ended up spending 30 bucks on this great game. In a press release back in 2006, Ritter also said, "Minions of Mirth gives the player an incredible amount of freedom in their role-playing experience. It can be played in single-player, multiplayer, and even allows friends to run their own custom persistent worlds. We're very pleased to be releasing this amazing product. We've worked very hard with our community to make sure Minions of Mirth totally rocks." Though it may sound like they had rushed to a release, Minions of Mirth opened with a huge assortment of features, including 16 classes, 12 races, and hundreds of quests. Even though it had full world and plenty to do, there was still more work that needed to be done, and this is where the community really became a huge part of the game. The team continued development of the game, but decided to invite the players into the development process and allowed them to experiment and create things for the game, including quests, characters, dialogue, and even items. The community quickly began working together and creating even more for the MMORPG, and the small indie title began growing more than anyone could have imagined. This is about where my personal journey began with Minions of Mirth. When I got into it, it was around 2007. I was only 14 years old, doing dishes at a local restaurant, and didn't want to spend $15 a month just to play an online game. I had better things to spend my money on, like Dr. Pepper and Cosmic Brownies, so I became a huge fan of free-to-play games and would search through gaming websites that would share links to games that you could download. I think Steam probably existed around this time, but I didn't use it myself, and I would download games from their official websites, try them, and if I didn't like them, delete and go to the next one. I worked my way through several websites and lists, downloading and deleting games, looking for the perfect match. Free and perfect. As you can imagine, my 14-year-old brain had a difficult time. I was thinking just about paying the monthly cost to play WoW or EQ. I had grown up playing games like Diablo and EQ with my dad and uncle. But as I got older, I always wanted my own account. I was close until I came across Minions of Mirth. I read through some of the forums and saw the diversity of classes, dungeons, and the amazing community. This looked too good to be true. I went to the official website and began the download. Could this really be the game I had imagined in my head all this time? Once downloaded, I jumped in immediately, and I began talking to a guild that was just outside Trinst, the main city where you start. I was surprised how helpful everybody was, and how they answered all my questions. It not only had the features I was looking for, but the graphics bore a striking resemblance to my starter MMORPG, EverQuest. And this was all for free? I continued playing and was shocked at the depth of this game, and all the cool things that I hadn't seen before. I was so happy to have a wide assortment of classes and races to choose from, but it also featured a multi-class system. Even though my first character was a bit of a silly role, with the multi-class system you'd think of going tank, damage, healer, or something practical. And I did, eventually. However, my first character was a warrior, wizard, thief. Because I had reasons. The combat was very reminiscent of EverQuest, and each battle felt earned. You could choose between different skills and spells to use, and the large array of weapons and armor allowed for a custom fit to your playstyle. By buying the game for $30, you unlocked the premium features, like the ability to add a third class or a tertiary, and to get all classes to level 100. You could max out all your skills, you could unlock stronger monster templates, and much more. It was definitely worth it, and soon I even had friends from school logging in and joining the guild I was in. This continued another year or two, but eventually I ended up phasing out of the game as my responsibilities grew. I had school and sports, work, friends. It began to be too much to stay up all night killing skellies with people I'd never met from around the world. I set the game down and I forgot about it for a while. Then in 2014, through random conversation, one of my friends brought it back up. Curious that night, I checked to see if it still existed, and sure enough, there it was. I downloaded it and logged back online, and the world was almost exactly as it had been left. Not much had changed, but the community was still raving about it, and it was cool to see this, and it felt like it would live on forever. Unfortunately, in 2017, almost out of random, they announced that they were shutting down the servers. It said that they had been having issues with their server, and that it just eventually fried, destroying everything. Even after trying over and over again to try to fix it, they were left defeated. While I couldn't confirm this anywhere, several other videos have suggested this. However, people were devastated and took to social media to talk about it. Many wanted to start private host servers and continue to play with their friends as they had for so many years. I've tried to look for some private servers in 2020, but unfortunately I couldn't find any. It's hard to tell if people would even be able to host a server with what's left of the game. Fortunately, the game wasn't completely gone, as they had a single player mode that you could still download and play. You've seen some of the footage from one of my offline games here, and though it's not obviously the same, it's still a great rainy day thing to do. You can find the link in the description below if you'd like to play. The only thing I've noticed is that whenever I kill something or one of my party members dies, it does this weird freeze frame thing. I'm not sure if it's from the file that I use to download or what it is, but it's not too big of a deal breaker for me, but it can be distracting. Minions of Mirth had so much going for it, and it was so unique in its features. As you progress through the game, killing different monsters, you would actually unlock that creature, and you could turn it into a playable version of it. I remember unlocking some, but I couldn't remember much about the actual gameplay of them. I think it was just more of a, let's see if we can do something like this kind of thing. Minions of Mirth had a tremendous amount of NPCs, items, quests, and the class system was something really fun to play with. Of course, like any other MMORPG, it had things like crafting, enchanting, raids, and all the usual tidings. Perhaps the most curious thing, though, is the Minions of Mirth social media, which will still occasionally light up like a beacon in the dark and post an odd thing about the game. On October 9th, 2019, they posted Minions of Mirth Mac Edition is not compatible with macOS Catalina. This immediately raised a flag with old players about the possibility of restarting the game, but Minions of Mirth has remained silent in the comments. Since the days of creator Josh Ritter, Prairie Games has undergone a lot of change, partnering up with Digital Monkey, a game art training and production house that mainly focuses on publishing iOS and Android games. Minions of Mirth had a big effect on my early gaming life, especially for my love of MMORPGs. If you have played it or know anyone who has figured out how to host privately, please let us know in the comments below and let's try to reconnect. The biggest thing about this game was the community, not only being together, but literally helping build the game to what it was. Maybe one day we will all play together again. In the Minions of Mirth.